let's sing the last verse on hymn 529.
It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe. Who in his sorrow bends a heart that none can bend in love. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
And God's people say,
I just feel extra privileged to have joined that very, very special club.
Amen.
The 60 and whatever else after that. Amen. So praise the Lord. God is good.
All the time. Amen.
That I, you know what? If you had a 60-year-old car, you'd be in big trouble, wouldn't you? But hey, the Lord is good. Amen. Just reminds us that these bodies that we have here are only temporary. Somebody say hallelujah.
Amen.
The older you get, hey, look at Daniel saying amen. He's not even, what is he, 15? I mean, what do you mean? But what a blessing. God is good. Amen. Better have Daniel come on down here, open this up in prayer. He's actually.
Good morning, everybody. Let's all pray. Our God in heaven, I thank you for your tremendous grace and your power that you've demonstrated in our lives by saving us who call upon you, Lord. And I pray, Father, for today's message. Be with Pastor Miller. I ask that you would fill him with your Holy Spirit. May he teach the word of God, and may he show us, Lord, today's message, and may it speak to our hearts. And I pray, Father, for the fellowship and the food after the service. I ask, Lord, that we would gather together in unity, and I pray, Father, that your spirit would be in the midst of this assembly, and I pray that your will be done this morning. I ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's all be seated. Another thing about birthdays, are a good excuse just to eat. Amen. How about that? And everybody stick around after the service. I had to get done about 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, something like that, and we'll all be hungry by then, amen? It'll be a blessing. You know, you talk about it, birthdays being used. I can remember many years ago, Mario, I think it was Mario, when you first started coming to Maranatha Baptist Church, he had, it must have been like his 20th birthday or something like that, and he invited a lot of folks from the Filipino community to his birthday, people that they had met, that they knew, and he used it as an opportunity to get the gospel out, amen?
Amen.
I remember he, well, I'll tell you what, one thing for sure, if you ever get invited to a Filipino birthday party, you better go. The food is so good, I'm telling you, so good. But we had the opportunity, I remember Mario invited some of our gang that love to tell people about Jesus to the birthday party. And he had his preacher come down from Chicago and preach to these guys. And it was such a blessing. And then we got to see many of them trust the Lord that day. And what a joy that is. And that's what these kind of special occasions are for. Use them for the glory of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You didn't think I could remember that far back, did you? That was 2006. Boy, he was only 25. Yeah, something like that. Something like that. Amen. Announcements. Announcements. You see the one on top there. We can get past that one. How about Faith Bible Institute? Faith Bible Institute, FBI, spring semester starts Monday, January 16th at 6:30. And it goes from 6:30 to 9:30. It's in the fellowship hall right over here on the south side. And anyone may attend the first two Mondays. Audit the classes. You can be there for free for the entire class. Actually, it's three classes per night. And You know what? Just come. Come and check it out. Come and see. Come and see. And I guarantee you, you will be blessed. Ladies' Fellowship. We will have our next fellowship on Saturday, the 28th at 3 p.m. All ladies are invited to join us. We always have a blessed time. And you know what? Come on out for that. And ladies, encourage some of our new ladies to be there for sure. Let's get everybody out for that. Quarterly business meeting, Sunday the 29th, following the evening service, will be our quarterly business meeting. All members are encouraged to make plans to attend. Amen? And let no man despise thy youth. February 10th and 11th will be our youth conference with Evangelist Mike Fisher, Brother Fisher. So thankful for what the Lord is doing already in your ministry. Brother Fisher will also be preaching here Sunday, February 12th. Exciting times. Let's be praying ahead of time. Let's already be praying for Brother Fisher as he gets into the schools. It's so exciting to see the schools that he's getting into. And I love to see the responses on social media, especially when some of you remember that that was the school that you went to, and now we're getting Brother Fisher in there to be a light in a dark, dark world. Amen? Also, contribution reports, they are in the foyer. You need to pick those up. Amen? Any other announcements? All right.
Since Pastor is 30 years old again, for the second time, we'll sing a birthday song for him. Again to him, 539. Oh, that will be glory. 539.
Just to be the dear Lord. sinners Jesus will save. All he has promised that he will do. Wash in the fountain open for sin, and I will pass, will pass over you.
One more time, please, and let's turn to him. Number two, numero dos, come thou fount of every blessing. Number two.
Look to the Lord for us, sir.
Let's pray. Humble, gracious Heavenly Father, again we gather in your house this morning, giving you all the praise and all the glory, thanking you for your Son, for your word, for our salvation. Lord, open our hearts this morning, dear Lord, as Pastor Miller, you can present your word to us this morning, dear Lord. Fill them with the Holy Spirit. Now that we pick up this offering, Lord, we pray that you multiply it and be used for your ministry, Lord. We pray all this in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. You know, I'm always kidding about how if I lead music, I'm going to be singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Matter of fact, if I had it my way, special music would be What a Friend We Have in Jesus. The invitation hymn would be What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Not only because it's the only song I know, but it's such a special, special hymn. This fella, Spivin, who wrote this song, was anonymous for many years. He actually, and I love the backstory, don't you? I love to read about these hymn writers, because most of them weren't hymn writers. They were men and women of God who wrote from their heart. They wrote poetry, and it was often then put to music. And that's exactly what happened with Spivey. Joseph Spivey was in Dublin, Ireland, a young man, engaged to be married. And the day before he was to be married, his fiance died. It was a strange, kind of a weird accident. She had been bucked off of a horse and thrown into water and drowned, actually, the day before. He was very, very distraught, and it drew him, and this doesn't happen all the time, does it? It drew him closer to the Lord. It drew him closer to the Lord, and then when he decided, I am just committed to serving the Lord, he loaded up everything and headed to the Americas and moved to Canada, actually, and for 10 years, he served there and was used by God. Found out his mother was sick. And so that was when he wrote this poem, which we're about to sing, to his mother. How about this? You would think, well, he's had more than his share of tragedy. Then he meets someone else, a young lady in Canada, and is engaged to be married, and she dies just before they are to wed. It drew him closer, even closer to the Lord. For the rest of his life, he fully committed himself to serving the Lord with all of his heart, all of his mind, all of his soul. Think about that when you hear these words. Amen? What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer.
Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. find a solace there.
Thank you, Pastor and Mrs. Miller. Let's dismiss our children now.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Amen. Truly thankful for all our musicians. What a blessing they are. And every time I get the chance to sing, I appreciate them even more. Amen. Most of you preachers out there, if you sing a little bit, you're glad to get that part over with so you can get to the part that you feel a little bit more, I don't know, called to. Preaching, amen? Turn in your Bibles, would you? Turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. And please notice with me verse 10. Even as I begin reading, you're going to think, wow, preacher, you read this the last couple of weeks. You know what? I'm going to read it again. Amen? Ephesians chapter 6, notice verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. I like that, don't you? Stand. Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. And that's where we're going to stop. That's where we're going to focus today. The breastplate of righteousness. Notice again, the last part of that great verse, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 14. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. Paul continues to detail the various pieces of armor we must utilize if we are to be victorious in our continuous conflict with Satan and the forces of evil. And let me tell you, folks, Satan is real. The forces of evil are real. After emphasizing the belt of truth that supports, organizes, and promotes efficiency, Paul goes on to speak of the breastplate of righteousness. Now, this we can relate to, right? This particular piece of armor gave protection to, are you ready? The breast. But not only the breast, but the back, the neck, and really the hips. It was kind of all around. It was somewhat similar to a modern cavalier vest. You know, are you thankful for the men and women in the armed forces? Are you thankful for those that are protecting us as first responders, yes, in many cases, but our police officers, our law enforcement, I'm thankful for them. And, you know, they'll be the first ones to tell you that they can relate to this breastplate that we're talking about, the vest that they wear. And you think mostly of your police officers because 24/7 almost, they're wearing this kind of protection because you never know. Isn't it true? You never know when the enemy might hit. You know, if you only had to prepare when you knew for sure you were going to be attacked, it would be one thing. But for the Christian, we understand that we can be under attack at any time. And so this breastplate was made of small pieces that were woven together so as to provide protection for the vital organs of the body. Paul admonishes Christians to put on the breastplate of righteousness. Paul, examining a Roman soldier, could see the application. A good preacher always does. You see, the righteousness of God is the activity of God in setting things right. And it's God who sets things right. I want you to think about this for a second. Through Jesus Christ, God the Father set things right with man and between man. God's plan is that we should receive to our credit the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ through faith. And you see, God makes us right with himself on the basis of our faith in our Savior, in Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 3. Notice verse 11 with me. Don't you love Galatians? That's kind of a little mini Romans, isn't it? Galatians chapter 3, verse 11. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I'll tell you, the more you study the Word of God, the more you appreciate what it means to be born again, what it means to be a child of the King. And with that said, are you ready to be an ambassador for the Lord? Are you ready to step out and prepare yourself as a good soldier to meet the task that is before us? Some of us might think it's time to relax. We might think, well, you know, hey, look, guess what? You know, we are thinking that due to this recent election, Washington might look more kindly on Christians and we might have more opportunities to be a little bit more comfortable. Listen, don't get comfortable. And let the Lord take care of the White House. Let us focus on the church house and get the job done. Amen? Let's not put away our armor today. Let's not stop and say it's over. It's only just beginning. And so as we focus on this breastplate of righteousness, appreciate, would you please, with me, what the Lord has for us. Notice, number one, the breastplate of righteousness, not a righteousness of our own. It's not. And you see, that's what faith in Jesus Christ is all about. Paul had sought to protect himself from the accusing finger of a guilty conscience and from the weakness of the flesh by a righteousness based on perfect obedience to the law. While this performance might not have been perfect, it surpassed that of any of his contemporaries. And then you read Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7 describes the agony of his heart as he discovered that there was no real protection from sin and guilt through attempting to achieve a righteousness of his own through obedience to the law. Have you ever, are you thankful for Romans chapter 8, that victorious chapter? Don't forget Romans chapter 7. Notice with me, Romans 7, 21. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. Notice verse 23. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is my members. And we know this verse, don't we? Verse 24. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. If you've been alive on this planet for even just but a short period of time, you know what it means to battle with sin. Amen? And if you've been saved even but just a short period of time, you know that the battle continues. And you know that this war going on between the flesh and the spirit is one that's going to continue on this side of eternity. Paul proclaimed the message of grace that provided spiritual protection. This is what we need. You know, it's so easy, even after you've trusted Christ as Savior, to be dejected and defeated. There are too many Christians today who have no clue that they can enjoy a victorious, they can be victorious Christians. Spiritually speaking, there are so many Christians today that they're saved, they're on their way to heaven, but they're struggling so much. And maybe for you, you're here today and you're thinking, you know, I got to tell you something. I hear preachers talk about the victorious Christian life and how we can be victorious. And I just continue to fail. I continue to falter. And I don't know what I can do. And there's where the problem lies. It's in I. It's not about you. My friend, it's about Jesus Christ and what he's done for you. You see, we see that they were threatened by their own weakness and helplessness. Can I tell you, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior this morning, I can absolutely guarantee you, you are experiencing weakness and helplessness. And you know it. Even that fellow who lives across the street, who has the perfectly manicured lawn, 1.7 beautiful children, and a beautiful wife and a great job, knows that he's miserable. He may not show it, and he may not even look it, and you may not even think that he knows it, but he does. How many times have you begun to speak to someone, and all of a sudden you find out things aren't as great as they seem? Things aren't as good as we thought they were. That's probably one of the reasons why we don't often share with people. We think, well, they look like they're better off than we are. We still haven't gotten it together, and they seem to have. You see, that's not the case. And then even after trusting Jesus as your Savior, even after getting saved, if you don't make up your mind that you're going to put on the whole armor of God, focusing on the breastplate of righteousness today, you're going to continue to struggle. You're going to continue to see defeat. You see, they were threatened by the strength of evil inclinations and degrading habits formed in the past, just as we are today. How many of you got saved as adults? It wasn't until maybe adult starts at about 40. Amen. So isn't that what they're saying? They're saying that especially for men, and this really makes sense, right? a man's mind, brain isn't even fully developed until they're close to 30. Durley, do you believe that? Yeah, Durley believes it. Amen. Can I tell you something? You and I both know if you got saved later on in life, how much baggage you brought in to your salvation. Amen? How many would agree with that? How many would agree with that? And you know, I'm thankful for a good testimony. Sometimes we think, I heard about one guy who thought his testimony wasn't good enough, so he decided to go out and build it up a little bit more. Got some tattoos and went out and did some things, and that way he could really talk about it. You know what? The best testimony is to get saved early in life and walk with the Lord for the rest of your life. Amen? That's the best testimony. But the real truth is, we come in with a lot of baggage. We really do. They were oppressed by the devil who was continually seeking to destroy them. Paul knew what that was about. The early Christians knew what that was about. And you know what? You and I know what that's about. They were threatened and confronted with an evil environment that was not conducive to spiritual growth. Hey, would you say that that's a whole lot like the way the world is today? How many would agree that today, the environment in which our children are in, no matter how protective we are, isn't conducive for spiritual growth? I can tell you, we homeschooled our children at least once or twice a week, amen? and we were amazed at some of the things that would create. This just shows you how old my kids are, okay? Are you ready? They didn't grow up with, are you ready? Listen to this, kids. Justin and Karen didn't grow up with cell phones or really even much of a computer. They weren't exposed to, there was no such thing as social media. Yet the world has a way of creeping in on us, no doubt. Notice, secondly, the breastplate of righteousness. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. Now, I don't want to get into weeds with this, but I will. And it will seem that way if you don't pay close attention. Look with me at Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. Philippians 3, 9. And be found in him, and then notice, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. You see, Paul found security in the position that was granted to him by the grace of God on the condition of his faith response to our Savior, Jesus Christ. When Paul recognized that he was clothed in this perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ, it served as a bulletproof vest, a cavalier vest that would protect vital organs of his spiritual nature against all assaults and accusations. You see, it's understanding who we are in Christ and what we have in Christ that is our cavalier vest, our spiritual vest. You see, dressed in the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ, Paul was persuaded that nothing could separate him or other believers from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Paul responded to the certain salvation that is provided through Jesus Christ with some significant questions as he contemplated the time when he will appear before our Creator God. Let me tell you something, my folks. When we read in Romans chapter 8, that great victorious chapter, verse 33, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. That speaks to us. Justification, don't you love that word? I hear this was one of the ways that we preachers were taught to explain this word. Justification means that you are standing, your righteousness is imputed, it is given to you, you are putting on Christ's righteousness. And now the Lord sees you just as if you had never sinned. Justification is an act of God in which he declares believing sinners righteous and acceptable in his sight on the basis of their faith in Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 5 verse 1 says, therefore being justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I got to tell you something that matters to you and I today as born again Christians. So, who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Romans chapter 8, verse 34. Paul affirmed that believers will not be condemned by Jesus Christ on that day because Jesus Christ loved them to the extent that he died for them and conquered death and the grave. And he presently renders a ministry of intercession on their behalf. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Oh, these wonderful words just grab a hold of our heart. Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors. Don't you love that? Dunamis, super conquerors, more than conquerors through him that loved us. Those last verses there in Romans chapter 8 are verses that encourage the Christian today. You know, Paul is encouraging believers to recognize and respond to the truth that the great crises and tragedies that befall them are not to be interpreted as indications that they have been separated from God. No way. You cannot be separated. Are you ready for this? Christian, you cannot be separated from the love of God. When you've trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you cannot be separated. You no longer are alone, never again. Unless we dress ourselves in this bulletproof vest of God's righteousness and recognize our relationship to him, we can still struggle as though we're not protected. God doesn't leave you. But there are times when you choose not to walk with him. I mentioned this before, but I remember it was 1994. It was in Lancaster, California. Paul Chapel had just built a beautiful building, and they had a church service at Lancaster Baptist Church. And his guest speaker, who I saw on television just recently, was Dan Quayle. How many remember Dan Quayle? If you're under 20, do you know who Dan Quayle is? Anybody? If you go to school, do you know? Okay. Can you spell potato? Some of you got that. And I'll never forget Dan Quayle sharing, thinking, here a man, and by the way, I'm thinking, could it be, again, that man who is a heartbeat away from the presidency has a testimony? I mean, what a blessing. Dan Quayle talked about how he had trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior at 17 years of age. And he then went on to share that he didn't continue to walk with the Lord the way that he ought to. Matter of fact, into his 20s, he knew that he had gotten far away from the Lord. And he can remember just crying out to the Lord. And the Lord asked, he felt like that the Lord clearly asked him this question. Dan, you've gotten away from me. You've gotten far away from me. My question to you, Dan, see, God can call the vice president Dan, amen. My question to you, Dan, is who moved? Who moved? And Dan Quayle knew that it was he. It was he who had gotten away from the Lord. All the protection that he enjoys, all that this breastplate of righteousness represents. He was not utilizing. Are you farther away from the Lord today than you were, let's just say, even last year, last month, since you got saved? And if so, who moved? I mean, who moved? I can guarantee it wasn't the Lord. His protections are there. That hedge of protection that he wants around you is available to you. I think it's time to step back in and get dressed up. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. And then finally, please notice the breastplate of righteousness, the protection it provides. The breastplate of righteousness, the protection it provides. And you know, if you'll just think about how a cavalier vest will save a police officer's life because it protects vital organs, it'll help you to appreciate how important the breastplate of righteousness really is. Someone has declared that one cannot go to heaven without a perfect righteousness. Now stay with me with this. In view of the fact that all people are lawbreakers and sinners, this leaves us in a hopeless condition unless somehow we can receive a righteousness from God. And you know, this is what the world doesn't understand. To illustrate this truth, someone has said it is, in order to go to heaven, you must have a perfect record. This is where we say, oh my. We do not go to heaven on our own record. That's the key. We don't go to heaven on our record. Instead, through Jesus Christ, we are given his perfect record, and we go to heaven on the record of the one who lived a sinless life and then died on a cross as a substitute for sinners. That's what we have in Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, folks, that's special. That's important. The breastplate of righteousness, a Christian's bulletproof vest. This bulletproof vest will protect us from the guilt and the sins and the imperfections of the past. No matter how near or distant that past may be. God does not want us to spend our lives in melancholy meditation on our failures and mistakes and sins, wallowing in our pity. He wants us to be able to face the future. He wants us to face the future with joy and assurance and confidence that our sins have been forgiven. Let me tell you something, folks. That's why I am so excited about telling people about Jesus. I haven't gotten over it yet. I'm never going to get over the fact that my sins are forgiven. I'm not in chapter 7 anymore, oh wretched man that I am. I am now dunamis, more than a conqueror, a super conqueror in Jesus Christ. And that's who we are. That's what we have. The breastplate of righteousness, the Christian's bulletproof vest, will protect us in all our future days. We can face detention. We can face, that sounded like I said detention almost. This would have really fit for me back in high school. We can face temptation with greater strength because we are assured of the strength and the resources of our God. Can I tell you something? It's so important that we get this. We have a God who loves us and who has high hopes for us living the victorious Christian life. Some of us, you need to know this, my friend. Stop listening to the lies of Satan who has convinced you that you are a failure, that you cannot live the victorious Christian life. That is just not right. That's not of God. That's not the scripture. And you know, the first thing you need to realize is who you are in Christ. And then walk in it. In other words, let me use language that makes more sense to me. Be who you is. Amen? Do what now you are. Isn't that what they say? I think, so therefore I am. It's more than that. It's God says, this is who I am, and now I need to believe it. We can endure suffering and disappointments in the awareness that these do not necessarily indicate withdrawal of God's love for us. God is not loving you when you're going through tough times. The man who wrote that beautiful poem to his mother understood that. When he wrote, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," he had already suffered more pain than most of us will ever have to suffer. And it drew him closer to the Lord. And for you and I, we can't even imagine that we would never marry because then our second fiancé would tragically die before we wed. Yet he grew even closer to the Lord. I'm not saying that I would be so strong in the Lord to be able to do that. But this demonstrates for us what we're really talking about. You know Romans chapter 8, verse 28 is so misunderstood, isn't it? We know that all things work together for good to them that love God. And it really is true, though. It does. I'll tell you what it doesn't say. It doesn't say that all things are good. It doesn't say that, does it? It doesn't say all things are great and wonderful and everything's going to be great. It says all things work together for good. To who? To God lovers, born again Christians. To them who are called, the called, according to his purpose. It's always about his purpose, isn't it? It's always about his purpose. The breastplate of righteousness, the Christian's bulletproof vest can protect us from fear as we face the fact that one day we will meet God before the judgment seat of Christ. Amen? Romans chapter 8, that very first verse, there is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. That's why we preach a lot on the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We talk a whole lot about walking in the Spirit, choosing to walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh. It is through faith in Jesus Christ that we move into a position that removes the possibility of our being utterly condemned and rejected on the day of judgment. Amen? Amen and amen and amen. John chapter 3, verse 17. The Gospel of John, the greatest, probably the most popular book in all the Bible. Chapter 3, probably the most popular chapter in all the Bible. And following the most popular verse 16, we read verse 17. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned. Somebody say hallelujah. He that believeth in him is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already. Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. It's not something you can be on the fence about. It's not something that you can be neutral about. You are either in or out. If the Lord were to put it this way, it would make sense to us. You're either with me or you're against me. John chapter 5, verse 24, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me, having everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. My friend, if you're here today, you can't even appreciate how important the breastplate of righteousness is until you put on Jesus Christ, until you trust Jesus as your Savior. According to the scripture that we just read, if you're born again, if you've trusted Christ, you can never be condemned again. And if you haven't, you're condemned already. Maybe that doesn't make a lot of sense, but that just shows you that God's on the throne and in control. Trust Jesus today. In a group this size, there may be even one here who doesn't know for sure that if you died today, that you're going to heaven. My friend, listen to me carefully. Say yes to Jesus Christ. And then be able to rejoice in the fact that, as we just read, that you shall not come into condemnation, that you will have everlasting life. You will pass, are you ready? Right now, instantaneously, it cannot be reversed, from death into life. How about that? How about that? And you know, for the rest of us, don't you think it's time that we get back to walking in who we are? And when we put on the whole armor of God, we recognize that this breastplate of righteousness protects us in such a wonderful way, because we are walking in the protection of the Lord. Let's all stand together. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, no looking around. I mean, I just want to say this for just a second. Friend, if you're here today and you're not sure that you're saved, today's the day, my friend, today's the day. Don't walk out of this place without knowing for sure that you're on your way to heaven. During this invitation, don't worry about who's looking. Don't worry about what anybody else is thinking. Be more concerned with getting things right. Come forward. Let us show you from a Bible how you can be saved, how you can be born again. Let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart. You know already the Lord's speaking to your heart. You come forward even during this invitation. Father, we thank you and we praise you. We pray your blessing upon this invitation. We pray in Jesus' name.
Open your handbooks, please, to 331. 331.